Wherever you lead me, I will follow. I will follow. I will follow. Wherever you lead me, I will follow. Lord, I will follow, I will follow, I will follow, I will follow, yes, I will follow, I will follow, wherever you lead me, I will follow, yes, I will follow, I will follow. 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 Yes, I will follow. Lord, I will follow, I will follow, wherever you lead me, I will follow, I will follow, I will follow, wherever you lead me, I will follow. I will follow, I will follow, I will follow, yes, I will follow, Lord, I will follow, I will follow, wherever you lead me, I will follow, yes, I will follow, I will follow. Wherever you lead me, I will follow. I will follow. Yes, I will follow. I will follow. Wherever you lead me, I will follow. I will follow, I will follow, wherever you lead me, I will follow. The doors set the captives free. You open up my eyes so my eyes can see you now. Let me see you now. I wanna see you now. I wanna see. Doors and set the captives free. Open up my eyes so my eyes can see you now. Let me see you now. I wanna see you now. Let me see. Doors and set the captives free. You open. opened up my eyes so my eyes can see you now. I wanna see you now. Oh, let me see you now. Let me see you now. Oh, God, of all, here we are, standing in your presence. Oh, God,
oh,
your glory. Hear your glory, your glory. Hear now, Lord. Your glory, Lord. Your glory. Your glory, your glory, your glory, your glory. Come rushing in, let praise begin, true praise begin. Come rushing in. Rushing in, let praise begin, true praise begin, Lord, here, here among your people, here among your chosen, here among your saints, oh, we pray,
divine grace.
find grace. Yes, with floods of mercy, divine grace. Yes, with floods of mercy, divine grace. Oh, eternal power fills this place. Eternal power fills this. You fill this place. You fill this place. Lord, you fill this place. This tabernacle you purchase. You purchase. Fill this place, Lord, you fill this place, Lord, you fill. With the glory of heaven, with the glory of the eternal, your glory, your glory, your glory, your glory, your glory, Lord, your glory, your glory. Your glory, your glory, your glory here, your glory, your glory, your glory. Floods of joy. Floods of joy, floods of grace, floods of grace, floods of joy, filling this place. Fill this place. You fill this place. Fill this place. gospel. The floods, floods of mercy, divine grace. Oh, the floods of mercy, divine grace. Feel this place. Feel this place, Lord. You feel this. Lord, come invade every part of us, Lord. Come invade every part of us, Lord. Come invade every part of us, Lord. So that we might participate in your promises. All your promises. We rise and shine. 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 We rise and shine with your glory. We rise and shine. 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 For you, Lord. your glory here. Put your glory, your glory. Put your glory, your glory here. Put your glory, your glory. Put your glory. Your glory. Take us deeper, God, than we've ever been. The heights with you. A city. Oh, I seek a city. The heavenly city whose builder is God. Oh, I seek a city. Oh, I seek a city. We worship. We worship you, Lord. We worship. We worship. We worship you. We worship. We worship. We worship you. We worship. We worship. We worship you. And we bow down. We bow down. We bow down. We bow down before you. We bow down. We bow down. We bow. We worship. We worship. We worship you. We worship. We worship. We worship you. We worship. We worship. We worship you, Lord. We worship. We worship. We worship you, Lord.
We want to see your glory, Lord. Feel it now, we pray. We hunger and thirst for your righteousness. We long to see your kingdom come. For the return of your Son, Lord Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. We'll be right back. Lord, be magnified in all this earth. Be glorified in all my life. Reveal your glory and let it be known that all creation is
How precious are your thoughts towards me. How precious are your thoughts towards me. How great is the sum of them. Oh, how great is the sum of them. How precious. How precious are your thoughts towards me. Oh, how precious are your thoughts towards me. How great, oh, how great is the sum of it. Oh, how great is the sum of it. Serve you all my day. Lord, I will serve you all my day. Lord, I will serve you all my day. Yes, I will serve you all my day. And I'm gonna dwell. I will dwell. Dwell in the house of the Lord all my day. Oh, I will dwell in the house of the Lord. I will dwell in the house of the Lord. I will dwell in the house of the Lord all my day. I will serve you all my days, Lord. Yes, I will serve you all my day. With joy and gladness, with joy and gladness. mercy surround me. Lord, your goodness and your mercy surround me. Lord, your goodness and your mercy surround me. You surround me. You surround me. You surround me. All around me. All around me. You surround me. You surround me. Your goodness and your mercy surround me. Lord, your goodness and your mercy surround me. Lord, your goodness and your mercy surround me. Lord, your goodness and your mercy surround me. You're a shield about me. You're a shield about me. You're a shield about me. Lord, you're a shield about me. You're my glory and my lifter. You're my glory and my lifter. You're my glory and my lifter. Jesus, you are. You're my glory and my lifter. You're my glory and my lifter. And I will serve you all my days. You all my day. Yes, I will serve you all my days. Oh Lord. Yes, I will serve you all my days. Oh, with joy. Oh, with joy. Oh, with joy. I will dwell in the house of the Lord. I will dwell in the house of the Lord. I will dwell in the house of the Lord all my days. I will dwell in the house of the Lord. I will dwell in the house of the Lord. I will dwell all my days. Your goodness and your mercy surrounds me. Lord, 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 your goodness and your mercy surrounds. Lord, your goodness and your mercy surround. There's nothing like your goodness, Lord. There's nothing like your goodness. Nothing like your goodness. Nothing like your goodness. You who hold the ages. Your goodness and your mercy surrounds me. Lord, your goodness and your mercy surrounds me. Lord, your goodness and your mercy surrounds me. Lord, your goodness and your mercy. And we will dwell in your house. We will dwell in your house. We will dwell in your house. We will dwell in your house with you. We will dwell in your house. We will dwell in your house with you, Lord. For all eternity. For all of time with you. Your goodness and your mercy surrounds me. But your goodness and your mercy surround 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 me.
Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, glory to your name, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. Father, we thank you for revival fire. We thank you for revival fire in this place. Lord, begin with me, oh God. Every one of us, oh God, revival fire in this place. Revival fire, Father. Let your revival fire fall on us because we're so desperately and hungry to see you and behold you. Lord Jesus. Because we will not allow anything to distract us, Lord Jesus, from seeking your face, from beholding you, from knowing you. Lord, let your revival fire fall on us. Hallelujah. Jesus. 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 We thank you, Father, for the glory of your presence. We thank you, Father. We praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, that you remove every distraction. Father, and you cause your people, Father, to gather up and to stir themselves up and remind themselves, oh God, what you have done in them. Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father, for a stirring up, a stirring up, a stirring up, a stirring up. Father, that not at one moment, not one day, not one time do we take things casually and things, you know, just normal and as usual. But Father, every day and every moment seeking your face to go to a new place in you, to behold you like we've never beheld you before, to see you like we've never saw you before. Father, God, to keep ourselves in the anointing in the realms of the Spirit like never before. Your glory, Lord. Your glory, Lord. Father, you're awakening, Lord. You're awakening in this place. Father God, we just ask you to move by your Spirit, Father. Lord, I just stand here as your vessel. yielded to you because I can do nothing of myself. I have no ability in and of myself to do anything. Lord, only what you're doing is all we want to do here tonight. We want, Father, your word to take root in the heart of every person. Father, to pierce the heart. Father, to go deep into the heart of every person and bring change, Father. Show forth the light of your glorious gospel in every heart in this place tonight. Bring the change, O God, by your Spirit. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, let your glory pierce through all the stuff, all the confusion, all the doubt, all the busyness, all the laziness. Lord, let your word pierce through. And Lord, may we take a hold and run with the fire like never before. Every one of us running with the fire of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Oh, hallelujah, and realizing, oh God, what you have called us to do, Father, this sacred, glorious walk with you. Father, may we count this walk with you so dear, so dear, so dear, Lord, that we don't count our lives dear to ourselves, but we count everything that we are and everything that we've had, Lord, but as dung that we might obtain. Unto this glorious gospel that you've called us to. To this glorious gospel that you have called us to, Father. Lord Jesus, you and you alone. I thank you for a people that will have no other gods before them. That will not set up idols before them. That will have nothing, Father, that they desire after and long for except for you, Jesus. You and you alone will be our desire. Hallelujah, Jesus. We praise you, Father. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We praise you, Father. We glorify your name. We glorify your name. We praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. There's some people in here tonight that you haven't stirred yourself up yet. You're still half asleep and you're still stuck with the busyness that you've been involved in. You want to stir yourself up with, right now, with the anointing and the glory that's in this place. Father's loving on you, just love on him. He's here loving on you. You don't have to figure it out and go, oh, I did this, that, or the other, and me, me, me. Just get your eyes on Jesus, and he'll just love you back. Just love on him, and he'll love on you. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, glory to your name, Jesus. Glory to your name, Jesus. Yeah. Yes, Annalyn. And Father's always saying, lift up holy hands and praise me. Lift up your holy hands and just worship him and praise him. Yeah, yeah, push through and worship him. Yeah, amen.
Father just says, lift up holy hands and praise him. Break through all the stuff, all the circumstances, all the situations, all the sickness, all the disease, all the distractions, all the doubt. It doesn't matter if you haven't saved someone since 1995 or whatever. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you're going through discouragement. Lift up holy hands and praise him because he's holy, because he's mighty, because he's your God, because you gave your life for him, because he's so beautiful. Don't forget how much he loves you. Just open up your mouth and praise him. Break through all this stuff. Break through all this stuff. Break through all the circumstances. There's breakthrough on the other side. There's breakthrough on the other side of those walls. Just lift up holy hands and praise him. Open up your mouth and praise him. Open up your mouth and praise him. He is holy. He is mighty. He is your Savior, your God, your Redeemer, and he's the lover of your soul. So praise him like he is. Praise him like he is.
Jesus. We worship you, Almighty God. You know, if you'll forget about yourself and your stuff, you'll forget about you. And you'll just begin to worship him, you will go away. Because he'll take you up to a higher place. If you forget about all these things that you can't figure out and the pieces to the puzzle that you can't get worked out, there's, you know, you've got these things hanging on and you can't just seem to put it all together. And you're trying to figure it out. And it's holding you into a place of where there's no glory and no joy. If you'll forget about you, it's holding you in a realm of you, not in a realm of him. He wants your eyes off of you and look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Look to him, look to him, look to him, look to him. Not you, not what you can't figure out. You lift your hands and you worship him, and he will come and he will meet your needs. He will answer. He will answer you. He will answer you. You will get the breakthrough. You will get the breakthrough. Because, you know, if you realize that he's standing there, a God of love, to love on you. Any moment you call on him, any moment you step aside over here to get into his presence, he's there waiting on you. He's there to hang out with you, to take you up into the realms of his glory and the realms of his presence, so you don't have to be stuck on you anymore. So you can live in him and him in you, not you and him and him and you all surrounded by everything. You want the Almighty in control, not you. Not you. Not you and your stuff. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. He's the glory and the lifter of your head. He gave you beauty for the ashes. You had nothing but ashes, and he traded it in for beauty. He said, you give me your ashes and I'll give you beauty. You give me. Your sadness and your sorrow, and I'll give you joy. You give me your mourning and I'll give you joy. You give me your heaviness, your depression, your sorrow, your figuring out life, because that's miserable. And I'll give you the garments of praise. So do you know, do you listen to that? The answer is, when you feel cast down, when you feel heavy, when you feel burdened, realize that Father traded that out with you for praise. So what do? You get up and you praise. You get up and you begin to worship. And when you worship and you praise, you begin to forget about you. And the powers of darkness that are trying to bring a deception to hold you in bondage and in captivity when Jesus has set you free, when you begin to open your mouth and praise him, it has to go in Jesus' name. Yeah. Hallelujah. It might sound meager when you start because you haven't started your engine for a while, because you've been over here in this place of heaviness for so long. But if you'll just get your hands up and you'll press in, he will touch you, and glory, the glory of heaven will fill your soul. The glory of heaven will fill your soul. And you can live here all the time. And you don't have to figure anything out. He'll figure it all out for you. Just ask him and he'll tell you. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
cara, balambo tolo bene lì, la sa cara, rosci li le mandi, retete.
You just want to let the river flow. You want to let that river flow out of you. He said, out of your bellies would flow a river, a river, a river, a river of living water.
Sita, jibata, it comes up from the inside out. Hallelujah, Jesus.
And Father wants to bring you to the place that this river is flowing all the time. It's not sometimes. It's not just on Wednesday nights, Sunday mornings, Sunday nights, Thursday nights for the youth, and Friday nights when Pastor Mark does the teachings on Revelation or School of the Spirit or whatever. It's not just when we come to church, but it is who you are in Him. And I have to say, most of the people in the abiding place are there, a large portion, but God wants to take you deeper. He wants to be your all in all. He wants to be everything to you. He wants you to see Him as that pearl of great price, that precious pearl of great price, that when the man found it, this is what the kingdom's like unto a man seeking for that precious pearl. And when he finds that pearl on this property, he goes and he sells all that he has, everything. He completely loses his life. All that he has and all that he's been to receive this precious pearl of great price. Is he the pearl of great price to you? Have you seen him as everything that you're willing to let go of all of your life, all of your decisions, and just say, I want to be like Jesus. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. My life is no longer mine, but I'm dead and I'm buried and I'm raised up together with Him. Woo! In heavenly places together with Christ Jesus. I don't live in this earthly life. I don't live an earthly existence. I live a heavenly existence because I have gone after that pearl of great price and I have let go of me. The reality of that in every action that we have, a big one that we can be tested in all the time is when something comes down on us pretty heavy and we begin to defend ourselves. That one just really, that ugly thing really wants to rear its head. But I'm dead and buried with Christ Jesus. Amen. And Jesus never, he stood before them accusing him of one thing after another. And they came up with all kinds of false witnesses, and they started accusing him when they were trying to find fault against him so they could crucify him. And their witnesses didn't match up, so they keep looking. And Jesus just stands there. Guys, you know, probably thinking, mercy, can you do better than that? But he didn't open his mouth. He didn't open his mouth. And that even shocked them. He shocked them from beginning to end. From the time he appeared on the scene to the time that Father took him up and he ascended up right in front of the disciples on that glorious day. He shocked them. He blew them away. It was like never a man ever spoke like this. But Jesus, you know, in defense of himself, Jesus did not even open his mouth. And they said, don't you have anything to say of yourself? And he says, the high priest says, are you the Christ? And he says, I am. I am. I am. I like that. When Moses stood at the burning bush, he said, who shall I tell the people that is sending me? And Father spoke back. The Lord spoke back. I am that I am. And Jesus said, I am. I tell you right there before he said anything else, that made them mad. I am. Because that put him right there in the unity and the oneness of the Father. They knew what that meant. They knew I am meant that he was claiming to be as and in the Father. I am the Christ. And from this day forward, we can look at that in Mark real quick. I want to make sure I don't quote anything wrong that is so gloriously precious. And it's in Mark chapter 14, verse 62, and Jesus said, I am, and you shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. They were done then. Why? Because they sought their own. They sought their own glory. They sought their own will. They sought their own plan in life. And Jesus was disrupting their plan. In other words, God Almighty was disrupting their plan as they thought that they were the leaders sent from God for Israel. God Almighty was disrupting their plan and they didn't like him and they're like, away with him, kill him, crucify him. But bringing it back down to the life that we live, realizing the world that we live in, that it is so imperative that we keep our focus and our eyes on Jesus and on the things of the Spirit, that we don't come under the deceptions of this world, the powers of darkness that work in the children of disobedience. You look at that, the powers of darkness. That is what causes Satan to be the prince and the power of the air. Is because the children of disobedience give place for him to be the prince and the power of the air. If everyone lived for Jesus wholeheartedly on this earth, Satan would have no place. If no person gave him place, he would have no place. If the church that is supposed to be the church of Jesus Christ didn't give the enemy place, we would be shining so bright in this nation, in the nations of the earth. And we would be such a hinderer of lawlessness in this earth as the church of Jesus Christ that wickedness could not abound to the extent that it has. And I say it's time for the church to stop bowing their knee to the powers of darkness and giving Satan place through the church to run rampant right up the middle of this country and the countries and the nations of the earth. It's because of what we, the church, is doing. And we are here to declare and to birth a people by the Spirit that will not allow the enemy any place whatsoever in their life. Because we don't want anyone to think that they're on the way to heaven and be deceived in their heart because they allowed the enemy to deceive them through the things of this life and world, the cares, riches, and pleasures of this world. And as it is said by so many, say this prayer with me, pray this prayer, do this, and then now you're saved, you're going to heaven. Go off on your own. You got it. If you continue in my word, then are you my disciples. If you love me, you keep my commandments. If you love me, you keep my commandments. If you say that you love me and you keep not my commandments, you're a liar and the truth is not in you. It's not in you. Who is the father of lies? If you're a liar, who's the father of lies? So who's your father? If you say you love him and you don't keep his word, then you're a liar and the truth's not in you. What's the remedy to that? Realizing the pearl of great price. Realizing what Christ has done in you. The light that he has brought in you, that you don't have to be bound in darkness any longer. That you can live free from every power of darkness that would try to rule and reign over you. No longer do you have to be held in that bondage. And when you take a hold of that liberty and that freedom, and you walk it out and you realize, I mean, I think it's good for the church to realize that when you sin, and if you sin, amen, you have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. But look at that word, if you sin. I mean, he makes a way. If your eyes get off of that love and glorious relationship that we have with him, he makes a way for us to come back to him. He's so good. But at the same time, sin has bowed its knee to Satan. And do we want to have our knees bowed to Jesus as the love of our life, as the lover of our soul, as the pearl of great price, as everything, as our answer and our total and completeness in him. And through him, not of our own ability, completely of his own ability, but this is what he's done for us. This is what he has done for us. Do we only want to bow our knees to him? One of the biggest parts in this of people understanding of how not to get over in deception, and Pastor Mark talked Sunday night about how Eve was deceived and Adam was in transgression. Adam knew what he was doing, but Eve was deceived by Satan. Deception is the biggest thing that takes people out. But if you will take a hold of love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For he that loves the world has not the love of the Father abiding in him. That is a separation from the world. Come out from among them and be ye separate, says the Lord, and I will receive you unto myself. You can't hold hands with the world. You can't go along with the world's standards and do what the world is doing. You can't dress like the world. You can't act like the world. You can't walk like the world. You can't talk like the world. And you can't listen to the music of the world. Now that's a big one. I'm amazed at how many Christian people turn on ungodly music. And I want to say that very clearly. Ungodly music. Even country and western. That somebody done somebody wrong song. Even that. Why? Why? Because worship. Music is worship. What we had up here tonight would come out of the throne room. That's worship. That leads us in to the place of worshiping him and adoring him and glorifying his name and lifting him up and praising him. You can go back and you can watch people in the era of the 60s when the Beatles came on the scene, before, after, all in that time when all of that stuff went on, and it continues to go on, people go into frenzies. The things that women did during those worship services, of that stuff that is birthed right out of hell. The effect that music has on your spiritual man. And you think that you're going to come and you're going to fellowship with that and you're going to partake of that and then you're going to go pray in the Holy Ghost? That's not the Holy Ghost. Let me just tell you, you need to understand worship. You need to understand music. You need to understand that it is written out of a spiritual realm. And it's either written to worship the Almighty God or it's written to worship Satan. And he's going to make it look good and pretty and just like, you know, everything else he tries to package up nicely. And then you open it up and it's a atom bomb when you really get to the depth of it. And it will destroy your soul in hell. And God's people have to separate themselves from things like that. I don't care who it was writing the song. People go, well, we'll go back and we'll listen to Mozart. You know, he was a great composer. He was a demon on wheels. He was the devil himself manifested. If you know any history about those composers, a lot of them. And I'm, look, people, wake up. Separate yourself from the world. All of it. All of the world. Love not the world. The world's not your leader. The world's not what you're supposed to follow. Their fashion or anything else. Not to say that you can't put together good fashion out of what you're able to go buy, because everybody doesn't have a sewing machine. But you can present yourself as holy, chaste, virtuous, pure, righteous. Looking like Jesus. Acting like Jesus, because we're hid in Him. Our lives are hid in His. We're not to live our own life and figure it out for ourselves. We can pray about everything and God will lead us and direct us and show us everything we need to know. In every aspect of our life, if we just don't go headlong on in our life and do it how we want to, when we want to, where we want to, like we want to. But if we will stop and say, Father, is this your direction? Father, what are you doing? I pray over my grocery shopping. I pray over my clothes shopping. I pray over my parking spaces. I pray over my vehicles. I pray over my wash machines. I pray over everything. I ask God what's wrong with them. If something breaks down, it works. And it makes it a whole lot easier to get the things fixed, because when you go to a mechanic, they'll go, well, it's the starter. No, it's nah, it's the generator. No, it's the... And after you've spent bukus of money replacing all the things that went wrong with it and it still doesn't work, they'll go, well, I'm at a loss. And that's expensive. So just pray over it in the first place. David and I, we were out. We had gone to Florida to Rodney Howard Brown's to a big convention he was doing in the convention center down there in Tampa before he started his church. This was a while ago because he's had his church for a long time. And we were getting ready to leave this meeting, and our van that we were in just started shaking. Like, we turned it on and suddenly it's just like, you know, and we have 13 hours to drive, and you can imagine. And, you know, so I'm just like, okay, Lord, can we take this vehicle? Can we drive it, or do we need to stop? What do we need to do? And I laid my hand, just simply, I laid my hand on the dashboard of that van, and I said, okay, Father, should we go ahead and drive this where we need to go, or should we fix it, and what's wrong with it? And the Lord said, yes, you can go, and it's the motor mount. And so, I don't know what a motor mount is, or I didn't. I have a clue. I'm not a mechanic. But my husband knows about all those things, and so does my dad. And so we got it to Mississippi, where we were going, to stop off before we headed on. And so I told him, I said, it's the motor mount. And they said, it's not the motor mount. Both my dad and my husband, they're telling me. I said, well, the Lord said it's the motor mount. And they said, well, it's not the motor mount. And so they changed out the starter, and they changed out this, and they changed out that. And I, you know, and each time I go, well, could we please just check the motor mount? Because we're spending this money and it and those things, because God said it's the motor mount. And so finally, they checked the motor mount. And guess what? It was the motor mount, whatever that is. It's something in there that holds something up. And see, it's really good when you don't know stuff. It's really good. Because then God can show you what you need to know. You know, we have this truck that's, you know, a charm. Now, I'm getting on vehicles. We, you know, and it's amazing. And so we turned it off one day, and it wouldn't start. And it wouldn't start, and it wouldn't start. And we tried it, and we tried it. And my husband said, we're going to have to tow that thing in and get it fixed, figure out what it is. And I said, well, I prayed over that thing. And I said, I felt like the Lord said, go out and start it. And I said, would you just please go out and try to start that thing one more time? He goes, okay. He goes out, tries to start it, nothing. So because I asked him, he tried to start it again. Clip. Started running. Perfectly fine. Kept running till it quit again. But anyway. We can ask Him whatever we have need of. He cares about everything. You know, when you only got a few dollars in your pocket and you need to buy a lot of groceries and that's what you have, you can either pray over multiplication of the money, which we've done. We've done that in the offering when we needed more offering to come in. And I used to be part of counting the offering, and this was at my dad's church. We prayed over the money and said, okay, Father, this is enough. We prayed over it and we're like, count it again. And it multiplied. And we're like, that's not quite enough yet. Count it again after we prayed over it. And it multiplied, and it was what we needed. That's fun. But you know, it was about the Father's business. It was doing the Father's business. And so you may have just a little bit of money, and you got to go to the grocery store, and you need to get all of these things. So you just say, okay, Father, direct me with this money. This may look like simple things, but it's all the way down to the basics. Direct me with this money. And then you go over here, and you find all of this good meat on half price. And it looks all normal to me. And you just load it up. And that money stretches. Because you know why? You just simply stopped and asked the Father. When we ask Him, when we realize that everything, He cares about everything for us. So it doesn't matter if you ask God to make you a multimillionaire or if you just ask God to direct you by the Holy Spirit in everything that you do and be the provision for you all the time that you always need. Both are working, but this one over here is better. Because it won't run out. The supply is never ending. It's never ending. It's a never ending supply. He is a never ending supply. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I just want to look real quick in Matthew chapter 6 at verse 22. There is so much in Matthew chapter 6. We could just read the whole chapter and just be here tonight and just get lost in the realms of His glory and His presence, because there's so much power in Matthew chapter 6 that if you will read it, if you will give yourself to it, if you take the Lord's Prayer, I could preach an hour on the Lord's Prayer. It's not the Lord's Prayer, it's on the disciples' prayer where they said, Jesus, teach us how to pray. Because there's so much power in that. There's so much in that the Lord is saying. We could just get raptured right here. But the Lord, I just keep hearing this. The light, it's in verse 22, the light of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye be single, your whole body is full of light. That's the pearl of great price. Your eye is set on Jesus. You've received this glorious fellowship, this glorious relationship, what He has done for you. And your eye is single upon Him. Your whole body is full of light. There's no darkness mixed. This is salvation. This is relationship walk with Jesus. This is what Jesus paid for us on the cross of Calvary. This single eye, like He had His eye set for the cross. He had His eye set like a flint. He knew the purpose that He came into this world, and He was going to accomplish it and fulfill it, and nothing was going to stop Him or take Him out. He would not be distracted. He knew His purpose. Can we know our purpose? It is in Him. And what He's done. This light that is all light and no darkness dwells in the light of the relationship and fellowship with Jesus Christ. If we will take a hold of this, the enemy can't deceive us and pull on us and make us think that we have to run over here, go over here, do this, or get distracted out of the light. If we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with the Father and the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son. Cleanses us from all sin. Yes. That light, that glorious gospel of light. Amen. Amen. If our eye be single, but if your eye be evil, the whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? If there's evil in that light, if you have an evil light, an evil eye, then there's darkness. You want to come to the blood of Jesus Christ. See, this light that lifts you up above the realms of this natural world where you would live to yourself, where you would allow yourself to be deceived by Satan. And where deception comes when you get over into your own thinking and your natural ability and you begin to process things and think it through in your mind. See, it's out of the belly the rivers flow. Out of the belly the answer comes. Out of the anointing. It's like the other day, three of my grandchildren, one of them, little Miss Evie that was up here worshiping, she's 2 and a half, and you have to say that, almost 3. Can't ever say 2, you have to say 2 and a half or she will correct you. And so they decide, because John Luke and Ethan were going to go home, they decided that they were going to go hide so John Luke and Ethan wouldn't have to go home. So we're all like, where's the kids? And we began to look, and I'm like, no kids there, no kids here, no kids whatever. In my spirit, I knew they were okay, but then my head got to working. And I'm like, but they're not here, they're not there. And I felt in my spirit, they're hiding. But I let my head go, we better be looking, and you know, I'm headed down the street, looking around, I'm like, where are they? And I began to function more out of my head, and my spirit and my knowing was they're fine. But you can let your head get in the mix. You don't want to go there. The Father gives you answers for everything. When you get into that, your thinking realm, there's where you can get led off in deception. And then the enemy's plan is to take you straight down into darkness. Just enough to send you to hell. If you go into church and, you know, you think, you know, you've got to have it all right with God, the enemy's looking for a way to deceive you to where you can continue going to church and live your own life and be on your way to hell, because Jesus isn't your first love. He isn't your all in all. And I think every person in this place could, you know, say ouch right now to a certain degree, because we get distracted. But we want to change the atmosphere and realize that the glorious light of the gospel has come to us. Now this glorious light of this gospel of Jesus Christ shines in our hearts. And now we're the light of the world, a city set upon the hill. And in us can be no darkness at all. And in us, what is the purpose? What is our purpose? It's to be the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, to shine bright to the nations of the earth. That is our purpose on earth. Once we come to Him, it's to show forth the glory. This is just the beginning of our eternity. This is a very short period of our eternity. This is just preparing us for eternity. And people feel like that this is what's it, and they have to live out their life to the fullest. As a natural person here on earth, experiencing everything that they can experience here on earth. And having all the things that they think they have need of. And Abraham set the stage straight. He refused to dwell in houses. He lived in tents. Because he was not looking for a temporal city, but he was looking for the city whose builder and maker was God. He cut it all out for us to look at. That we're not to live to ourselves here on this earth, but we're to be continually having our eyes on that city set, our eyes set on that city whose builder and maker is God, and realizing that everything in this earth is so temporal, it's here today and it's gone tomorrow. And not that you don't live and you don't go to bed at night and sleep and get up in the morning and eat breakfast, but God is your all in all as you are doing what you were doing. You're living in the light, the glorious gospel light. And you're not in a struggle anymore. Your eye is full of light. And if your eye offends you, if you're over here and you're so stuck in the natural realm and you haven't got that He is the light of the world and in Him is no darkness, and that light has come and shined in your heart, if you haven't got it and your eye offends you, then pluck it out, because maybe that will get you to understand and comprehend that there cannot be any darkness in your eye. If your hand offends you, if it keeps having to go and take something else that somebody else has, cut it off. I think we should have in there, if your tongue offends you, cut it off. Because that's the downfall of most people, is the tongue. Pastor Mark says, get duct tape. It's a good idea. I've looked at all the colored ones. They have fancy ones. You could even make it look stylish. But realizing, I mean, we don't even need to go here when we get lost in the light of His glory. But Father wants to bring everybody along. God loves us so much. He's continually looking for us to turn aside and see that burning bush. Come have that fellowship with Him. I don't think that's the first time Moses saw that burning bush. He's continually looking to see if we will be that man or that woman that He can use. But to start with, to have that relationship and that fellowship with. If we will be dedicated to that relationship and that fellowship. The way the things are going in our country and in the nations of the earth, I think we're all going to get some times to experience Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We're going to get to experience some experiences of Daniel being thrown in the lion's den. There's going to be those kind of fiery trials because you look at what's going on and how they're persecuting Christians and how not only do they want to have their agenda, but they want to force us to partake of their agenda. And if we don't stand against it, it's going to run even more rampant. But I tell you, the greatest way that we can stand against the powers of darkness that are on the earth today is by living in the light. Because the light shines light on the darkness. It brings the darkness to the light and to the answer of Jesus Christ. When we're shining bright, the powers of darkness have to back off. I don't like to give the enemy any place and anywhere in my life because I belong to Jesus. And He directs my steps. He orders my path. My life belongs to Him. The devil didn't get nothing. 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 There might be some resistance that the enemy brings up against you. He might hinder here and there. Paul said, I would come to you, but Satan hindered. But don't worry, he got to him. He didn't quit. He didn't give up. Satan hindered, but he didn't win. And he's getting no place. The Bible says give no place to the devil. No place. Not a little bit. Not for a moment. And we've got so much in this world today to allure people. You think of how our nation's gone since the 1920s, and that's when jazz music became popular, and they got the record player, phonograph. That's when that was first created. It is in the 1920s. And then you watch jazz music, and the way society began to crumble right then, the change in society in the 1920s. People want to blame it on this or that and say it was because of whatever, but jazz music began to go around with the record player for the first time, and it became popular. It started in New Orleans, Louisiana. Jazz music did, and then the record player made it popular, and people began to buy records and listen to all this stuff, and that worship that came out of that. There was a change in morality, began in the 1920s like had not been before. A change in immorality swept our nation. And then the radio was the next on the scene, and it just really exploded. And we went from there. And now, you know, we carry around things that can take us into all kinds of stuff so quickly. And I tell you, our children don't know how to stand against Satan. We're the keepers of our home. We're to pray and cover them with the presence of the Lord. We're to undergird them in prayer, and then we're to teach and we're to train them of how to conduct themselves. And I want you to think about how easy you forget and how much you have to have that fresh manna every day. You have to have it. If you haven't come to realize how you have to break that bread of heaven every day, or you'll be off in a place of forgetting yourself. They need that fresh manna of heaven. They need that fresh manna broken with them. They need you flowing in the Holy Ghost so you can speak to them in the things that the enemy is coming out against them with. When my kids were younger, I was in prayer for them continually. And, you know, I'd pray over them, and then I would talk to them about things that I felt like the enemy was bringing out against them. And boom, you know, you can't hide those facial expressions. They're just like, you know, and they're thinking, what's going on? Because, see, they're in a battle, and they don't realize it's a battle. It's not that they want to succumb to those things whatsoever, but the battle's there. The enemy wants to take them down. He wants to get our children. Things are directed at our children at 2-3 years old in this country today, and we've got to protect them. We've got to keep them from the garbage, because the television wants to desensitize them to the things of the world, and most people sitting in this place are desensitized to the power and the anointing and the things of God and the presence and the glory of God, because you have succumbed to your surrounding and what you've been taught. When you put it all away and you separate yourself, people talk about going on a sabbatical. You need to live on a sabbatical. You need to live in that place with God. But I begin to tell them things that I heard in the Spirit. And you know, when they got older, they said, you know, people tried to get us to do this and that and the other, and said, we think, oh, Mom will find out for sure, and she'll kill us. And so, no way. We'd tell them, no, we're not having no part of that. You know, people would try to, you know, slip around the enemy, just try to get the kids off somewhere, and somebody try to slip around and get them involved in something. And they're like, oh, no, our mom, she has eyes everywhere. She will find out. We don't know how she finds out everything, but she finds it out. I know how I found it out. I was on my knees, and God took me and showed me what the spiritual battle was and how we got to gird up. And I tell you what, I fought a battle in that, and I didn't fight enough. I wish I would have gone deeper and pressed in harder, because you never, the deal is you never finish raising your kids. Till you're in the grave or you're raptured, that's when you're done. You're there to carry them in the Spirit for the rest of their life. When you bring a child into the world, God has given you that child to raise for so long, but to carry in the Spirit for the rest of eternity, for the rest of your life. And to carry one another like that. And we do. We pray for you guys. You know, as we're praying, you know, the Lord just brings different people before us. I had somebody call me up the other day that used to come to the church, and the enemy tricked them, and they left the church with just some kind of stupid thing. And they called me up and they said, we want to come back, after a bit of talking to them, because I knew when they called. I said, you know what, I've been praying for you. I was just thinking about you the other day. And she goes, I knew you were going to say that. But see, because that's how God works. That's what he does. So we have a lot of responsibility in realizing who we are in Christ, that we're full of light. We are enveloped in his light. It's not someday when we get to heaven that all of a sudden our eyes are going to be single, and all of a sudden we're going to be full of light, and we're not going to be tempted by sin anymore. Jesus was tempted by sin, but he didn't succumb to it. He stayed in the light. The temptation may be there. But you realizing that you carry the light of the glorious gospel, you are the light of the world, you should not succumb to it. Don't be deceived. Don't allow deception. Don't succumb to the enemy's temptation. They don't belong to you. Tell the enemy to get off the property of God, to take a hike, to leave you alone, that he don't belong there. Don't go, oh no, I was thinking this. Then my mind can't, and then I've got an evil thought, evil thought, evil thought, evil thought. Oh, my. My, that thought, you know. Now, oh, God, forgive me. Cast it down. Cast down those imaginations. Bring every thought into the obedience of Christ. Take a hold of them. Put them in the place that they belong, the obedience to the Word of God. We've got it laid out for us. Everything Jesus said was out of the Word of God. Everything he did was the Word of God. So we line up everything that we do, visions and revelations and dreams, we line it up with the Word of God. I want to look at John chapter 7 real quick. Well, where does the time go?
In verse 15, and the Jews marveled, saying, how does this man know letters having never learned? How does he know letters never learned? He always astonished them. They were astonished by the authority that he spoke. He didn't speak like the scribes and the Pharisees. He spoke like he owned it. He did. But they couldn't comprehend it. Where did he come from? Where does he do these mighty works? How does this all, how does he speak with this authority? How does he declare the words of God with such power? Where do these miracles come from? How is this man doing this? They're amazed. Some of them were sent to try to trip him up in his words, and they came back going, never a man spake like he spake. He just silenced them or broke their heart. And they're saying, how does he know these letters? And Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine's not mine, but his that sent me. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. He that speaks of himself seeks his own glory. But he that seeks the glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. And no unrighteousness is in him. And no unrighteousness is in him. He doesn't seek his own, but he seeks that of the Father. We don't seek our own. We're his light. We're his glory. We're his representation. We're him manifested to the earth today. Are supposed to be. Jesus knew those letters because of the fellowship and relationship that he had with God. And he rose up early in the morning and he went out to a desert place to pray. He's 12 years old and his parents lose track of him and they go back and they find him 3 days later in the temple questioning the lawyers. And they're all shocked that this child knows so much. And it's because he knows the Father, and the Father knows everything. He knew where the donkey was when he told his disciples, go get the donkey, untie it, and bring it to me. And the disciples are like, okay, they go get, and he says, if any man says anything to you, say the Lord has need of him. He knew where the upper room was where he was going to go and share that Last Supper with his disciples. And he said, go and find a man who was carrying a pitcher of water. I guess it was a strange thing for a man to carry water, to carry that or something. Because, I mean, if all the men did it, you know, just think about it. Which man would it be? So they find the man. Here he is. He's carrying it. And said, go tell him that the Lord wants you to prepare the room for the supper. So they went in and he said, yeah, here it is. The Lord knew what was going on. He was prepared for the cross. He knew the plan. He knew the thoughts and the intent of man. And he wants us to be like him. Amen. And we got examples. We got examples. Paul, he was caught up into the third heaven. He said, whether the in the body or out of the body, I don't know. But I heard things that were unspeakable. And he brought revelation. And John, the revelator, he saw Jesus. In Revelation chapter 1, he beheld him. And the things of all of the things of Revelation, the letters to the church, where God has your number. He knows your uprising and your down sitting. He knows what you're doing. He knows everything. He knew what was going on in the churches. He knows what's going on in this church. He knows what's going on in every one of you.
And he knows what to speak to hit that place of your heart so you have the opportunity to repent. You know, you can either hear what the Spirit's saying, or you can say, well, that's Pastor Geneva's opinion, and I'm going to live my life like I want to, and I don't feel like there's anything wrong with that. And there's people that do that. But that's up to you. You'll stand before God for that. And you are judging the Word of God, because I stand in the office of the Lord speaking through me. And so you go ahead. You take that if you want to. I don't want to be there. I don't want to sit and make my own decisions off of what comes from the pulpit, unless it doesn't line up with the Word of God. If it lines up with the Word of God, I'm taking every bit of it. If it doesn't line up with the Word of God, and I haven't seen that around here where it doesn't line up with the Word of God. Because we live in the Word. Pastor Mark is a word machine. From the time he gets up till he goes to bed, he's just walking machine, just like my dad. My dad could preach 24/7, and he'd rather be doing that than sleeping. And here he is, 86 years old, still trying to find somebody to preach to. Still looking for somebody to preach to. So it's in our blood. Thank you, Jesus. But thank you, Father, it's in the Spirit above all things. Above all things. But you can make your decision, because God gave you a free will. He loves you that much. And he wants you to make the choice, if you love him that much, that you say, my life's yours, Lord. I'm not living it my own way. And Father, I'd rather listen and be obedient than to risk it and be wrong. Just go to the Word of God. Line it up with the Word of God. Fall on your face. Father will tell you, and he will take you to the Word. We're to live our life just like Jesus did. He knew everything that was going to happen. He knew what was going on. It's just like with Paul, when he was ready to go and die, he knew he was going to die. He knew what was coming. And all the people are grabbing a hold of him. The man that has this girdle, he's going to die. And all the people are crying, and he's like, don't break my heart. He goes, but I'm ready. I'm ready. I fought the fight. I've kept the faith. I tell you, the greatest fight you fight is to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and not back down. You might think that fight the fight to live right with God, that should be done and settled a long time ago. You need to get in the fight of preaching the gospel and not backing down with persecution or anything else that comes your way. Let's move on from the principles of the doctrines of faith. Repentance of sin. Let's move on from those things. Let's get it settled that we're the light. The light is in us and there's no darkness. There can be no darkness where there's light. It's either all darkness or it's light. So either get on the side of the light and bow your knees to the Almighty in all of your action and all your deeds, or clearly understand the boat you're in and that you've got your knee bowed to Satan and you're serving yourself and you're serving this world and you're serving the prince and the power of this earth. And the reason that things are going on like they are is because the church has got its knees bowed to the powers of darkness. And it's time that we rise and we shine, for our light has come and the glory of the Lord has risen upon us. We have his light. Let us be his light. Let us live out his light. Let us not just look at the word and pass it up as we go, yeah, 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 and I'm busy over here doing this and that, and I'm working, and I'm Martha busy about so many things. Let's be Mary's and sit at his feet and stand at his feet and show forth the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ and put down the powers of darkness. The more light that is shining, the powers of darkness has to flee. We're to be the hinders of lawlessness. If we want to move this program on the way it needs to go, we need to hinder lawlessness so much that Jesus has to come back and get us so we can get moved out of the way, so the thing can get ripe and fulfilled, so it can be over. the way in the dispensation of what we know now. This dispensation, because it's never going to be over. This earth is going to be forever, because he's going to move that holy city, New Jerusalem, down out of heaven onto earth. Once he's purged out all sin to where he's brought a people that will never, ever disobey again. Once he's purged it all out, he's going to move heaven to earth. And we're to live in that realm of heaven today and walk out his purpose and his plan. Hallelujah. And be this light shining bright. 1 Peter chapter 2. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Be ye therefore holy, even as he is holy. Be ye therefore holy, even as he is holy. Even as the Father is holy, this is what he's done. This is salvation. This is what he's purchased for us to be like him. For us to be like the Father, he is holy. For us to be like him, completely given over to living like him. A holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We're called out to be completely separated from the darkness so we can hear everything the Father's saying through the Spirit, so those rivers don't get stopped up to where we have to repent and get them started again. He's called us over into this light, completely out of darkness, no darkness at all. And as I said, the tongue is the number one thing that most people need to deal with in the things that we say. But love should be what's manifested from our mouth and our actions and our doing. Because, you know, we can go all the way. We can get so caught up, just like Ephesus did. We can get so caught up in ministry that we can even go to the place of giving our body to be burned. But if we don't have love, it is of no profit. It becomes religion. And I was in Tibet when the Buddhist nuns were setting themselves on fire to stand up for their country and their religion to be separated from the Chinese government, taking it over. And so they were in the square, and I was there at that time, and man, there was every kind of military personnel you could think of. They were everywhere, because the Buddhist nuns were demonstrating and trying to get it a big uprising going on around the world through media. Because even in Tibet, they have media. People will burn themselves, and they did. The nuns took torches and burnt themselves up. Live, themselves. Nobody did it. They did it to themselves, to stand for what they believed in. And went from burning themselves up right into an eternal hell. So we could give our body to be burned, and if we don't have the fundamentals of who God is, the foundation of who God is, he is love. And that love is where the light and the glory is. And love lays down its life. Love does not defend itself. Love allows God to take control and have his way instead of ours. Oh, thank you, Father. Oh, God, you're so good. We don't have to do it up here. We do it through the Spirit and by the Spirit. We walk out our life in this glory and this love relationship, knowing he'll take care of us. Something comes our way, a trial or tribulation comes our way. If we allow fear stops up that love and that glory from flowing, that answer, that word of knowledge, that word of wisdom. Perfect love has no fear. So we need to come back over here in him and know and trust that he is able to take care of us. Really trusting and believing
that He is faithful. He will supply all of our needs. Our focus is to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And He's going to take care of everything. He's going to take care of everything. Because you know why? And you know why the great provision is there? Is because your eye's not on it. You know, sometimes people just can't have stuff because their eye would be so on it and they would be so consumed with it that they would totally lose sight of their relationship with God. But when your eye's not there and your focus is on the kingdom, those things can be all around you and they won't matter. That's how our relationship should be in with God, because we're so in Him that the things of sin don't matter to us. We can step right over it and it doesn't even affect us because we're so caught up in the light of His glory. That sin is not a temptation. It doesn't even affect us because we've gone past that. You know, at a certain point, it's over in the sin realm. There's still all of the things that we deal with. You know, Abraham went all the way to Isaac being, what, about 20, 25 years old. So about 50 years after God called him out of Iraq area, yeah. Called him out of that area. About 50 years later, God says, now I know. There's going to be that testing and that trying up until the end. But we should be like Paul. To live as Christ. To die as gain. To live, I live for Christ. That I can be there to minister and stir you up. But to die is my eternal reward. See, that's complete abandonment. That's complete trust. Of letting go and letting God and not figuring anything out, just hearing what He's saying and doing it with Him, seeing what He's doing and doing it with Him, living our life out for Him. Every moment you can ask Him, okay, Father, what is your divine direction, your purpose for me? What do you want me to do? Lord, lead me and guide me. And as you pray, even when we pray, how many realize and know that we don't even come up with pray what to pray for? A lot of people have a lot of things written down that they pray for, and I'm not saying that that's bad. But I tell you what, I like the prayer of the Holy Ghost. And I'm not talking about speaking in tongues. I'm talking about when you get down and pray, and God brings to you what to pray for, and it begins to come out of your mouth, and you're like, it's flowing out of your mouth, and you're getting caught up in this glory as you're praying, and you're thinking, wow! I didn't even know that there was a need there to pray for that. Wow! That kind of relationship where you open your mouth and Father fills it, not you. The scripture, I can't think of where it's at right now, about where when you're delivered up, that might be Matthew chapter 13. When you're delivered up before the council, you know, because father will turn in the son, and the son will turn in the father, and brothers and sisters will turn themselves in. When you're brought before the council, don't even think about what you're going to say, because you'll be given the words to say, because the Holy Spirit will tell you what to speak. Yep. That's living our life out for the kingdom. Every moment, the Holy Spirit filling our mouth. The Holy Spirit directing us in what we do. Just pray about everything. Everything. You know, people make fun of people praying about everything, about parking spots. Hey, I pray for them when I'm in a big rush. I need a parking spot because I'm busy about kingdom business most of the time, and I need something in and out. I don't have time to dilly-dally. Pray about everything. God cares about every single thing for us. And then, you know, if I'm not in a big hurry, I won't pray for a parking spot maybe. Maybe I'll just take one. But, I mean, God cares. And He wants us to be focused on Him, to live out our life in Him and know what our direction is because we heard from heaven. And we're giving ourselves over to live in this life and this glory of Jesus Christ. That we don't count our life dear to ourselves, but we're willing to lose our life to gain His. Because if you don't lose your life on this earth, if you really don't, if you don't break it down to the simple part that you lose in your life, we want everyone to look at our life. Are we really? Yes, we've asked Jesus to come to our heart. We don't want, I mean, I would say everybody in this place is not one in godliness. They don't want sin. They don't want anything to do with the enemy. And they get tripped up with it. But if you get a hold of the light of the glorious gospel, He can't trip you up because you'll be aware of His devices. But the fact of, have we totally lost our life in this world? Are we a church that hangs on to the world? So we're over here with Jesus Christ, but we're hanging on to the world because there's things that we want and we want to do. And we're not letting go of the world. Have we really lost our life and we live the life of Christ? Every person in this place tonight needs to ask yourself, do you live the life of Christ? Do you live the life of Christ? Is what you say what Jesus wants you to say? Are you hearing from the Father and you speaking that? What you doing when you get up in the morning, is it living the life of Christ or do you live your own life? Everybody stand with me. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father God, that your word goes deep down in the heart of every one of us, Father God. And the change comes and we go from glory to glory to glory to glory to glory to glory to glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, by your spirit, Father, living in the realms of your glory, living in the realms of your anointing, living in the realms of your praise. Father, living in the place that you've called us to live out. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for your anointing. If there's anybody in this place that wants prayer, I want you to come. But as you come, I want to give everybody an opportunity to come and worship the Lord with what He's blessed you with. We have these baskets up here. And I want to give you an opportunity to come and worship the Lord because He's blessed us, everyone, so much. We thank you, Jesus, for the blessings of heaven. But if anybody's sick in their body and they need to be healed, Jesus is here to meet you. I'm not the one here to meet you. Jesus is here to meet you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Jesus is here to meet you. He's here to bring the answer. Whatever you have need of. If you've been going through some radical battles and you're losing, Jesus is here to meet you. He's here to show you the light of His glorious gospel. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for rivers of living water flowing in this place. We thank you, Father, that you're here to answer every need of every person. We thank you, Father God, for the glory of heaven. We thank you, Father, for the stirring of the waters. We thank you, Father, for the change. 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 We praise you, Lord Jesus. We praise you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
You are all we desire. All we desire, you're all we desire, Lord. You're all we desire, you're all we desire, you're all we desire. You're all we desire. You're all we desire. You're all we desire, Lord. You're all we desire. 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 You're all we desire.